these are certain broad aspects with respect to the Indian society or social structure, social issues and social justice. Now I think the relation between society, social structure and social issues and social justice, they are clear. Yes. No, no. You switched it off?
Yes.
Okay, then fine. So I think the relation is clear. Yes. Now once your relation is clear, now any phenomena that is asking you to evaluate any change or any social change, you can use the structure and write the answer. Right? This is one way of tackling a question which is in broad perspective and which you don't know any points. Now you don't know any points in Indian society or you are not able to understand question, then simply put the diversity elements and take the keyword of the question and evaluate it in. Okay. Now we'll see one of the important endogenic factor, that is your urbanization. See, the reason for me to deal with urbanization so early is it is an extremely important topic. First thing, it is an extremely important topic, and I think from past 3 years, at least 2 years, there has been a pending question with respect to an exclusive question on urbanization. Right, because I think from 2017 there was a conclave on urbanization and urban cities. Now post that conclave on urban cities in 2018, there was a question expected on urbanization. Now still it is pending, a standalone question on urbanization in fact. Okay, standalone question on urbanization. One reason is with respect to the conclave on urban cities. The second reason is there is a lot of policy churning that is going on with respect to creation of national slum rehabilitation policy. National slum rehabilitation policy, basically lot of policy inputs are being driven for in order to formalize and crystallize this national slum rehabilitation policy. So in this context, we basically need to understand the different aspects of urbanization. Now under urbanization, you basically need to know what is the definition of urbanization? You need to know the status of urbanization. One is definition, the other one is status. Then factors of urbanization. The fourth element with respect to urbanization is the consequences of urbanization. And what is the way forward? Now, when you look at the consequences of urbanization, here we would mostly deal with respect to slums. We'll mostly deal with respect to slums. As a consequence of slums, we'll talk about something called as urban poverty. Okay. So basically, this is the structure with respect to your urbanization. Now, tell me, what is urbanization? What is urbanization? Urbanization?
Primary cities.
Very good. Very simple definition. Raise in number of cities. Or basically when you are expanding the urban area. When you are expanding the urban area, it is urbanization. Okay, this is about urbanization. When the number of cities are expanding is a very simple understanding, or when you are multiplying or expanding the number of urban centers, or when you consider the urban centers as the growth engines of that particular region, is what is called as urbanization. Now there are different types of urbanization. Suburbanization, counter-urbanization. Suburbanization, counter-urbanization and peri-urbanization. These are different types of urbanization: suburbanization, counter-urbanization, and peri-urbanization. Now, when you look at this, suburbanization, basically when you look at the different factors of urbanization, you tend to understand that this urbanization is basically a consequence of migration. One of the consequences of urbanization is migration. The second factor for urbanization is your industrialization, your globalization, your modernization, your westernization. What is the difference between modernization and westernization? Basically, when you reciprocate or when you replicate or simply copy your Western culture, it is your westernization. Your modernization is more of an ideological basis. Your modernization is more of an ideological basis. It is more of an ideological basis. Now, in the sense, when the elements of scientific temper, when the elements of rationality, when the elements of humanity, when all such kinds of elements are incorporated in your ideology, then you call that type of development is what is called as modernization. That is what is called as modernization. So basically, when you look at the factors of urbanization, these are some of the important features. Now, when you talk about migration, there are different types of migration. One is rural to urban, urban to rural, urban to urban, and rural to rural. Now, when you look at this kind of migration, that is your rural to urban, it is basically a resultant of something called as push factors. Now, when you evaluate the factors that are responsible for your migration, they can be classified as push and pull factors. Push factors are those non-conducive factors which are not enabling or which are not providing for a decent standard of life in a particular area. Now, in order to escape such push factors, they go away from that particular area. And pull factors are those factors which are creating a conducive environment or ecosystem for a particular individual or section of society to live with decent standard of life.
Urban to rural can
be
said as pull factor.
I'll tell you. Okay. Now, because of this greater migration of your rural people to your urban areas, we see a concept called suburbanization coming up. Suburbanization. Now, when you talk about suburbanization, say for example, this is your urban nucleus. This is your urban nucleus. This is your rural area from which people are migrating. Now, because of high standards of living in this urban nucleus, one is because of high standards of living, because of high density, because of high cost, because of high levels of pollution. Yes or no? Because of improper certain, say, drainage channels or certain sanitation network. Now, because of all these factors, in spite of your urban center being the nucleus or growth engine of that particular region, what people start to do is, they start to occupy the fringe areas of this particular urbanization. satellite cities. The fringe areas of the urban areas or the urban regions are being occupied by your people. And who are, what is the concentration of these fringe areas? This is mostly your rural people. And comparatively lower economic section of the urban people. This process is what is called as suburbanization. Suburbans. Suburbanization is a process where the fringe areas of your urban centers develop. Develop because of the reasons of high cost, high standards of living, or poor health conditions or poor air conditions or environmental conditions. All such become the factor for suburbanization. This is what is meant by suburbanization. Now, understanding this suburbanization, now the second type of urbanization is counter-urbanization. That means which is just the opposite of urbanization. That means a kind of urban to rural migration is counter-urbanization. Now, what can be the reasons for urban to rural migration?
Lack of employment.
Good.
Cost of living.
Pollution. Lack of natural
resources. For example, your land. All these are reasons. Now, when you look at these trends of urban to rural migration, it is not your high economic class, but it is your. Sorry, it is not your low economic class, but it is your high economic class. Farmhouses, yes, or people who want good kind of natural environment, they basically try settling in rural areas. They shift from urban to rural areas. Now, don't you think because of such shifting of urban to rural areas in the form of counter-urbanization, don't you think the next consequence is your suburbanization? Because what are they doing? When your urban people are going to rural areas, they are going to expand this. They are going to expand this to such an extent that it becomes a part of your suburb. What is it? Why is your Meerut becoming part of your NCR now? Yes, the reason is this. Suburbanization, counter-urbanization. Now, what is peri-urbanization?
Twin cities,
okay.
On the
intermediate regions. The intermediate regions of urban and rural. When there is kind of urbanization phenomena that is occurring with the or in the this intermediate regions, then you call it as this region. You call it as peri-urbanization. And that is the reason why they have called about peri-urbanization, and with respect to agriculture also they have talked about something called as peri-agriculture. Now here FAO gives a formal definition for peri-agriculture. Please refer it. Your FAO gives a formal definition of peri-agriculture because it is one of the upcoming phenomena. Because when you hear concepts like factory farming, have you heard about something called as factory farming? Factory farming?
Practice in the westernmost,
it is mostly west. Factory farming basically involves a demand-based supply. That means, for example, for a particular community is going to hire some farmers and is going to say, my dear, you produce these and these vegetables for us. That is, basically, factory farming basically deals with demand-based supply. First thing, the second thing, it is mostly centered around your vegetable farming. Demand-based and vegetable
farming.
Are the types clear?
Yes.
One is suburbanization, counter-urbanization, and peri-urbanization. So I think definition, then types. These two are clear. Then what is the status? What is the status of urbanization? Around 32%. 32% as per 2011 census live in urban areas. And it is expected that urbanization or the rate of urbanization is going to increase up to 50%. Rate of urbanization is going to increase up to 50% by 2040. Now when they say about this rate of urbanization is going to be increased to 50% by 2040, don't you think one of the fundamental reasons is because of the evolution of types of urbanization? Either it is suburbanization or peri-urbanization, don't you think they are considered as urban regions only? Because they are mostly transitionary in nature. Yes, they are mostly transitionary in nature. Now because of the transitionary nature, it is anticipated that it is going to reach 50%. That means, suppose you say if 100 people are there, 50 people are going to live in urban areas. Now for such kind of accommodation, it is very obvious that these concepts have to be crystallized. Either you are peri-urbanization or suburbanization. And that is the reason why your FAO, I think in 2016, it comes up with the definition of peri-agriculture. Peri-agriculture is a concept basically to accommodate the increasing rates of urbanization. Is it clear? Now what about the factors? What are the factors? I think we already discussed. Migration, industrialization, globalization, modernization, westernization. Then high density of people. High density of people. And different opportunities for employment, different kinds of push and pull factors, right? These are the different factors of urbanization. Now, what are the consequences of urbanization?
Inclusive
growth. No.
Access to health.
Okay.
Infrastructure.
When you talk about consequences,
it can be divided into positive and negative.
Yes. Now your positive aspects or positive consequences of urbanization is basically whatever consequence is catering to the push factors of migration. For example, health, education, employment, growth, standards of living. Yes. Standards of living, health, education, employment, growth, standards of living. Standards of living basically includes even your modes of entertainment, then your transportation or connectivity or last mile connectivity. Your last mile connectivity. So these are certain positive aspects. Now, what about the negative consequences of urbanization? Negative consequences of urbanization?
Imbalanced mechanical life, yes.
Imbalanced regional development, very good.
Population.
Pollution. Deforestation, yes.
Pollution.
Okay. So basically, one, it is with respect to quality of life. Your quality of life when it comes to the basic needs availability. For example, your water, your sanitation, your air, all these are polluted. Yes. Then the cost of living. The cost of living. Then what are the other negatives? Cost of living, quality of life, shortage of resources, resource shortage. Right? Now when you come to your positive also, now one dimension you are supposed to basically look at this positive consequence of urbanization, because we are dealing urbanization as a point of Indian society. How is your social structure changing? How is it impacting your social structure positively, or how is it creating a kind of constructive social change? How is it creating a constructive social change?
Dissolving the caste barriers.
Caste to class. Yes. Diminishing the margins between, or differentiation or separation between different castes. Or reducing or normalizing the features of your caste system. Right? Then, caste is one. You need to bring in gender perspective. What is your gender perspective? Providing an employment opportunities, equal opportunities for the sustenance of women as a gender. The kind of domestic, professional, personal burden on women is on a declining trend with the impact of urbanization. Yes. What about family? Family, is it positive or negative?
Negative.
Yes.
Subjective.
Yes.
We cannot say like sometimes nuclear families may be good or sometimes
it depends. But mostly, as per your IP Desai and KM Kapadia, who are sociologists, they classify it as a negative connotation with respect to nuclearization of families. Right?
We can say more social inclusion of all different sections.
No.
Within the urban structures.
No. There is no social inclusion in urban structures. What is your gated community? Will you let you in? You take even your Benz car, they will not let you in.
That's true.
Why?
But different sections of the society will be living within the same gated
community. No. It's only like
light.
A light.
That's the caste has gone totally and new class has emerged.
But that has its own kinds of inequalities. We call them as stinking rich people. Stinking rich.
Stinking.
Right? Okay. So caste, gender, family is not there. What about your marriage? Intercaste marriages or interfaith marriages?
Very good. Positive or negative?
Positive one. See, as per as per your parents, my parents, it's on negative connotation. But as per UPSC, it is positive. I told you, no? The glass of optimism. I mean, no doubt in that. Okay. right? Your marriage, intercaste marriages and interfaith marriages. Then what about your kinship relations? Kinship?
Negative.
It is your declining trends. So if you are evaluating social structure on the basis of any phenomena, please remember this structure. One is caste, then family, marriage, kinship, then political organizations, then economic structures, culture as a whole. This is the general structure that you are supposed to remember when you are evaluating a particular phenomenon. Marriage, kinship, political organization, economic structures and culture. I mean, you can use it in evaluating any phenomena with respect to impact on social structure and culture in general. You can write
what is the third one, sir? Last one.
Which one? Last one is political. This is culture. Economic structure. Okay. So if you are evaluating any positive aspect and negative aspect, just look into these 6 to 7 elements. You will get a good structure. If you are able to get 3 points on positive, 3 points on negative, again your issue is done. Now tell me, with respect to globalization, what happens to each of these?
Caste.
Positive. Okay. Family.
Negative.
Okay.
Marriage positive.
Marriage
positive.
Positive. Okay.
Kinship negative.
Then
political organizations.
Political organizations is
positive.
Okay. Okay.
Wearing the optimistic lens.
Culture.
There is also a risk of homogenization.
Yes.
Risk of homogenization, maybe.
Culture, you need to be a little careful.
Even the economic structure also, like when we talk about globalization, some part of sections.
In economy also, you need to be careful about this inducement of inequalities. Any of this progressive phenomena, basically you would have this inequality creeping into the system. Okay, what about your political structure?
Positive, better relations, more accountability.
More accountability?
Diplomatic relations.
More soft power.
No, I mean to talk about when I'm talking about political organizations, you need to please remember the traditional versus the modern democratic institutions. What is the impact on this? The traditional versus modern democratic institutions?
Traditions will suffer.
Oh. traditional will suffer. Okay, traditional, for example, your Kap panchayats, for example, your tribal councils, for example, your village courts, what is the impact on them?
Less pass to them.
Security.
Less
power. Security?
Threats.
Threats, how?
Sometimes they will fund or fraternity extremism also in case.
Okay.
As modernization increases, traditional practices will decrease. Slowly decline.
So basically you need to talk about its transition from traditional to modern democratic institutions.
From the traditional itself, how we imbibe modern technology within the traditional itself?
No.
Let's say panchayats have evolved from, in the past how panchayats were there and now how the panchayats are functioning.
But when you look at the constitutionalization process of your panchayats, they are form of your modern democratic institutions.
But they are prevalent even.
They were prevalent in a different form, but you find that the traditional nature of your political organizations have metamorphosized into your modern democratic institutions. Is it clear? So if you are evaluating with respect to political organization, how this concept of urbanization or how this concept of westernization or how this concept of globalization has resulted in shifting from traditional to modern. Now when you look at your tribal issues, one of the tribal issues, you would find that there is a conflict between your traditional and modern democratic institutions. Now, because of this conflict between the traditional and modern democratic institutions of your tribal population, there is administrative deficit there. For example, if you talk about Goan societies, your Goan society, there is no conflict between your traditional and modern, but they mix up your traditional and modern. There are certain tribal societies who are adapting themselves to the changing nature of your political organizations. For example, the tribal head will be the vice president of your panchayat or local government. So basically, what is the nature of change that is happening here has to be evaluated in terms of this particular phenomenon. Now, it is mostly any kind of phenomena that we are talking, whether it is endogenous or exogenous, you basically need to see that there is a transition from traditional to modern democratic institutions. And in this process of transition from traditional to modern democratic institutions, what is happening is that true realizations of principles of governance is not happening, because there is conflict between these two, there is coordination between these two, or there is dominance of one of these, right? So keep these elements ready with you so that as per the question you can craft these elements. Now tell me about negative consequences of urbanization. Same in this social structure element. Caste is positive, huh? What about negative? Nuclearization of families, kinship, right? Kinship. Then when you are talking about the social structure, you can even talk about the ethical fabric of the society. That is nothing but your social capital.
How is it affected, sir?
Huh?
How is it affected by
which ethical fabric? Now, when your institution of family is being impacted, when your institution of kinship is being impacted, don't you think the ethical fabric of the society is going to be impacted?
Nudging within the family is lost as a result. It impacts on
the future citizens of India are tamed in the laps of mothers. This was 1 year's essay, I think. They are basically shaped as a future citizens in the laps of mother. But these days, instead of laps, they are being tamed by your laptops. Yes or no? Now it is going to, very certainly, that is the reason why, as one line of your syllabus, they have given about the role of family, society, educational institutions in shaping of ethics. Now, don't you think the role of family is declining with respect to shaping of ethics? Now the role of mother is being taken up by some caretaker or your nursery schools. Your kinship. Now children will call you by name. Yes. By name if they call you, you must be happy. Are ore anakapothe chalu. Right? I mean the reason behind this is, it is not about the criticism, but it is the declining ethical fabric with respect to respecting of elders. How many of us touch the feet of parents? All? On festivals? Not every day? We don't have the facility. Okay. So basically it is about the ethical fabric of the society is being impacted. So when you are talking about social structure, this has to be incorporated. Please remember. Now if you are incorporating this, it basically shows to the examiner that this fellow is able to relate the syllabus of GS4 with GS1. Is this clear? So that is with respect to consequences. I think in negatives, did we talk about slums? No? Please add that. I think all this result in slums. All this result in slums. Now basically when you are dealing with the process of urbanization, the main hindrance for you to realize the potential of urbanization is the slum growth or slums. Now what are the reasons for slum formation? One is unplanned migration. Very good. Unplanned migration. Lack of access to basic needs. Yes, for example, housing, sanitation, water, education. Then unemployment. Then we talked about something called as social maladjustments. Social maladjustments. What is the nature of slum you observe? One cluster of slum belongs to one community. Did you observe that? No? Or every community will be present in slums?
No, sir. Particular one.
That cluster of communities will be divided with respect to your slums. Now the reason behind such clusters of slums being formed as per the community or as per the region is because to derive a sense of security. To derive a sense of security. Okay.
And they also form in the groups basis of what they are doing.
Yes. They will have a common connecting element. They'll have a common collecting element. Or connecting element, right? Now, why am I talking about social maladjustments as a reason for slums is basically the people of urban areas. The people of urban areas ill treat these people who have migrated. Now, when they are Dandupalyam. A classic example for this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? Now social maladjustment basically means the Dandupalyam movie. Not RGV, some random guy. Okay. That you will understand the problem of the social maladjustment. There is a lack of sense of security from the migrants, and because of that lack of sense of security from the migrants, they basically want to ensure that sense of security, And in order to ensure that sense of security and safety among themselves, they go for slums, slum formations. Now, what are the consequences of slums? Can you talk about something called as unplanned growth? Or something called as skewed urbanization? Unplanned growth or skewed urbanization? What is the other consequence? Can I split the consequences of slums under societal level and individual level? This is more organized. Now, under societal level, you will talk about unplanned growth, you will talk about criminal activities or lack of sense of security or illegal activities or absence of law and order. All this? Sense of security. Or law and order. What is the third consequence under societal level? Social fabric?
Xenophobia?
Xenophobia or social alienation. Xenophobia basically means fear of foreigners. Fear of foreigners. Now at individual level, basically lack of access to basic needs. At individual level, basically it is lack of access to basic needs. Then lack of access to basic needs, then
opportunity,
peer. Can I say individual morale is on lower side? Basically lack of individual confidence, right? Now the other one is lack of economic opportunities. Lack of economic opportunities or a sense of social alienation. Is this clear? So whenever you are having the consequences, you can divide under individual and social level. Now what are the measures with respect to your slums? Or do you tackling the problem of skewed urbanization or slum formations? What are the measures? Rehabilitation. The first one is rehabilitation. Then
provision of basic needs.
Okay, that is only part of rehabilitation, basic needs. Then
awareness, learning opportunities.
Okay, any other point? City planning.
Yes.
Or something called as spatial planning. Urban spatial planning.
It is something called as urban spatial
planning.
Then
urban spatial planning, basically spatial planning indicates what region of your urban areas are going to be allotted to what kind of development. Okay, it might be townships, or it might be certain industrial clusters, or it might be for some kind of economic activity. Urban spatial planning.
The reinforcing of urban financing concepts.
Urban financing. Now basically urban financing and the robustness of your urban local bodies are interlinked. Urban financing and urban local bodies are interlinked.
See, when you look at your urban financing, one issue with respect to your urban financing is only 6% of expenditure a particular urban local body undertakes is derived from its own funds. That means urban local bodies have a 94% dependence with respect to revenue resources, either from your state or from your center. They are not independent, they are only 6% independent. But when you look at your rural areas, they are even more worse. It is only that 4% are independent, whereas 96% dependence.
But then if a local body has to raise the funds within their locality, with already the given skewed distribution, wouldn't it be difficult for a suppose, let's say, local body to raise fund from the slum itself? So it's actually a slum center, right?
Now we are not saying that it has to raise from the slum itself, but whatever other kinds of urban regions are there, they can go for, especially if they are able to efficiently collect property tax.
Is a property tax
from your main urban centers at least?
And those will be centrally
redistributed.
So that is where the 94% comes in, right?
No.
That is 6%.
6%, it is basically all of your urban local bodies.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Now that 94% comes from your state and center. So basically, we are seeing that, or we are suggesting, or we are advising that let your urban local bodies be financially autonomous, financially independent. Now, how can they become financially independent? They can become financially independent by efficient tax collection. Efficient tax collection from the core urban areas. And in your 2017 or 2018, I think 2017 economic survey, one of the classic case study your economy survey talks about is Bangalore. And it talks about the property tax collection efficiency of Bangalore. And it states Bangalore city as an model of example for collecting of property taxes. It uses satellite technology. Bangalore as a city uses satellite technology to collect taxes. Now every other city, I mean at least survey suggests that let other cities follow Bangalore model of collecting property tax. Now as per them, whatever kinds of expenditure your Bangalore is undertaking as a city, for them around 50% is from property tax. That means they are 50% independent. Whereas when you look at on an average, it is only 6%.
Are there any other modes of raising funds?
For example, your parks. Fees for parks, any kind of entertainment fees. For example, you go to Indira Park, after 8 o'clock you are supposed to pay 10 rupees. that can become a kind of revenue for your urban local bodies. Okay. So these are basic measures in order to look into. One is urban financing and corresponding efficiency of your urban local bodies. Then city planning or urban spatial planning. Then basic needs and rehabilitation. Is this clear? Now you can expand one line under each of this. I think you'll get 5 to 6 points, more than sufficient. Now you can even state, as part of rehabilitation, you can even state about promoting the concept of peri-urbanization. Basically, why do you think slums are formed in a particular region, or why? One is because of high land cost, because of rental, absence of rental housing. Three, because of availability of employment nearby. Yes. Now, when you look at your peri-urbanization concept, your land cost is low. If there is necessary state machinery which can create affordable rental housing, then that is also taken care. Yes. Then the third issue is with respect to employment opportunities.
The villages and they are migrating from the villages to the urban cities. So there are already being provided homes at the villages, but how can government again create new homes within the cities to cater the needs of these people? I did not get you. Like there is redundancy within of the property, right? They are having homes at the villages, but because of lack of opportunities, they are coming from migrating from their villages to these areas. So again, developing, like how can again government give funds or allocate funds for the same creation of houses or providing facilities again?
See, when you look at this migration as a phenomenon, it is not that whole of the family migrates, first thing. Few individuals migrate from a particular household. Now, when your few individuals are migrating from a particular household, and as you said, there will be a kind of resource burden on the government to create housing mechanism again in urban areas. But there is no other go other than doing that. Apart from what government has seen is, apart from going for permanent houses or giving permanent houses, they have gone for concept of ARHCs, affordable rental housing complexes. Affordable rental housing complexes. Now, what do you basically mean by these ARHCs or affordable rental housing complexes? You say they'll build one building. Now coming, they'll stay. They'll pay the corresponding rent. Once their work is done, they'll go back. That can be occupied by some other person. So that whatever extra needs of infrastructure that is to be created is restricted here. Now, in order to tackle this issue of slum formation, or in order to tackle this issue of rural to urban migration, Dr. APJ has suggested Pura model. Pura. Pura model.
So what is Pura?
I'm not able to recollect, that's what I'm trying. Just can somebody search it? I don't recollect. I mean, I'm not able to recollect.
In order to tackle urbanization.
Urbanization, I mean this rural to urban migration or slums as a phenomenon.
So I think you can search over there actually. That's
providing
urban amenities to rural areas.
Providing urban amenities to rural areas. Basically, Dr. APJ basically envisages that whatever kind of urban facilities your rural people are looking for, provide them in rural areas, so that this problem of slum or slum formation or urban slums will not be an issue. But that particular idea was discarded post 2012. I mean, he has given this particular idea in the year 2005. If I'm not wrong, 2004, 2005 he has given this idea. But after 2012, they have discarded on this.
But they are doing the same. But BJP government.
They have renamed it. That's it. JNNURM. They have renamed it. Okay. There are a number of schemes that they have. Your Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana is also kind of this only. Is this clear? Now, one of the consequences of or pronounced consequences of slum formation is your urban poverty. We'll deal about urban poverty when we are dealing with poverty as an issue. We'll deal about urban poverty. We'll deal or we'll see about urban poverty as a consequence of rural poverty. There is an inherent linkage between rural poverty as well as your urban poverty. Okay, we'll see what is the linkage there when we're dealing with poverty as a topic. Okay, any doubts as of now? Is it all fine? Right?
We are talking about slums regarding a rehabilitation on this problem.
Hmm?
So when we talk about Mumbai, Dharavi, so people are choosing it to remain it as a slum actually.
Why?
That is the reason, sir, I want to ask you. Because it's creating a huge economy, it's adding to the economy of the Mumbai actually. So why are they still maintaining it as a slum only? Why not they try to rehabilitate them or give some issue partners to them? Why not are they going
for? You tell me why. You, I think few minutes back you only asked me the question.
Yes sir, but
the answer for this question is that question only.
But as you said, ARHCs are catering to these needs. Why can't they at least create them at least?
I think they are working on rehabilitation part of your Dharavi, Surat slums, all this.
They are actually working, I mean, they are putting up apartments and all.
Huh.
Vertically,
yeah,
they are trying
to. ARHCs only.
In parts of Dharavi, they are trying to put up apartments so that they are vertically.
They are working on its rehabilitation. They will be there because.
I haven't seen any such center.
Because one thing is that when you look at your Surat, example, your gems and jewelry industry there, or diamond polishing industry in Surat, or when you look at the service sector, be it domestic services or transport services with respect to your Mumbai, the lifeblood of all these services or all these industries are your slums. Your slums. So the workforce, the amount or the magnitude of workforce these slums provide, it's huge at low cost. So certainly, like, I think it is logically conclusive that they'll certainly maintain this, not them as slums, but they'll look for the rehabilitation process. Because at the end of the day, they have come because of certain push factors and they have come certain because of certain pull factors. Right? Now, are there any positives of slums?
Same economy generation.
Okay, workforce. One workforce, right? Next. Next, any other advantage of slums?
Usually large companies get facilitated by them because labor laws don't apply to the slums usually. They are not a registered workforce. So? Private companies try to yield from them, try to reap the benefits.
So that we cannot say it as positive.
Like that.
Because it is illegal, no?
They are doing.
It is illegal.
It's illegal actually, but they are reaping the benefits
of them. One is workforce, good. Then economic activity. Three.
As you talk, sense of security and belongingness.
Can I talk about culture? Culture? Rural cultures?
But they remain isolated.
Huh?
Sorry,
they remain isolated. They remain isolated and
they remain isolated.
What is your vada pav?
Did it emerge from?
That was basically a resultant of a kind of rural food. It was not a cosmopolitan dish. I'm just giving an example.
Like I was thinking it came from Rajasthan.
No. Rural? Rural cultures. Rural cultures. What is the next advantage? One more advantage. Remittances to their source villages. From whichever region they are coming with an economic motto. They are earning some money and they are sending them back to their domestic regions or source regions. Now when they are sending back money for their source regions, don't you think it is going to lead to or stir up the economic activity in those regions? That's why your remittances to source regions. These are certain advantages of slums. Now when suddenly one fine morning they can ask you, what are the advantages of slums? Or they can ask you, slums, I mean the boon and the bane of urbanizations are, or the boon and bane of urbanization is slum. Comment or critically analyze. There you are supposed to talk about the positives and negatives of slums. Is it clear? What is the way forward? What is the way forward? What is the way forward?
Similar to measures.
Huh?
Similar to measures.
Yeah. Similar to measures?
City plans.
If you want to conclude urbanization, you conclude with something called as the concept of urban governance. You can conclude it with the concept of urban governance. Now, when you talk about the elements of urban governance, one is planning, the other one is financing, the next one is training. Planning, financing, and training. Urban planning, urban financing, and training of HR. Be it your the members of your urban local bodies. Right?
Can we also say upskilling of the slum?
Uh-huh. All this. So this is your way forward. Or if you want to still conclude it a little more specific, you can conclude it with National Slum Rehabilitation Policy. National Slum Rehabilitation Policy. Right? What is your tomorrow schedule?
Morning economy.
Morning?
We are having economy.
Economy. Till what time?
5 o'clock in the evening.
Half day. Day after?
Morning we have Vivek
sir's class. Day after is Saturday?
Yes.
Sunday?
Full day.
Full day is free?
Yes.
Mine? Okay.
Yes.
Mine, I mean.
No half day test.
Monday?
Monday is also.
Mine. Acha.
Sunday society.
See, basically last night I was in journey. So morning I came at 8 o'clock and by 9 o'clock I was here.
I'm having that fatigue to continue in the afternoon session.
So you can cover up
that. What? That's why I was asking about like what is the session with respect to you people. Can I extend tomorrow's session?
Yes, yes.
No issues with you people?
Sir, like, I don't know, sir, if I can't.
No, no, it's okay.
He's scared to answer
the
people will beat
him. Why?
Yes.
Why they'll beat you?
My opinions are different, sir. I mean, I don't mind if you take the entire day class, so that's
yes,
why I'm keeping myself shut.
So because, see, that's why I think Honorable Judge D.Y. Chandrachud, he says, dissent is the safety valve of democracy. So you have all the right to speak, no issues.
Sir, pressure goes out through the safety valve. Let me just remind you that.
Okay. So can I extend tomorrow's session?
Yes, sir.
So that we'll cover up whatever 3-4 hours today. Tomorrow I'll extend maybe till 6:37.
Okay.
Is that fine?
Yes.
Yes. Then day after we'll extend it to? Yeah. Certainly with break. Like day after also we'll extend it till 6:37. I think we'll cover up whatever afternoon sessions we have.
Okay.
Because tomorrow and day after I'll be having afternoon sessions.
Yes.
And Sunday whole day, Monday whole day. Then again in the evening I have to leave. Monday evening. So Sunday whole day. Whole day. No scope for holiday. Huh? Is that fine with you people?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, if it's fine with Chakrayana, then it's fine. He's the one who decides our fate as of
no,
for the next couple of weeks.
It's very much
fine. It's fine, no?
The only topic that has to be completed is society, sir. So we have time till 2nd of March. So we'll complete within that time.
Yeah. That anyway, I'll take care. Don't worry. If you people cooperate with me like an extra 1 hour, 1.5 hour tomorrow and day after, I think we'll cover up what we missed today in the afternoon session.
Okay.
Yes. So we'll meet tomorrow at 2:00.
Sir, I'll just inform.
Yeah, please no. Or call him, I'll talk to him.
Uncle,